understanding the programming process. All programming involves creating something that solves a problem. In general, the programmer's job is to convert problem solutions into instructions for the computer. That is, the programmer prepares the instructions of a computer program and runs those instructions on the computer, tests the program to see if it is working properly, and makes the corrections to the program. The programmer also written a report on the program. In the programming process, there are six phases: understand the problem, plan the logic, code the program, use software to translate the program to machine language, test the program, deploy the program into production. Understand the problem. In this stage, the client has problem and seeking a solution from the programmer. The programmer meets with users from the client organization to analyze the problem. In this phase, the programmer identifies the client's requirements and decides exactly what the solution should do to fulfill them. This may be the most difficult phase because users may not be able to articulate their needs well, and user needs may be changing frequently. So in this situation, the programmer also had to change the solution, and programmers may have to learn users' functional job tasks. For example, if the programmer had to make a system for a bank, he should know all the functions happen in a bank. And failure to understand the problem is the major cause of these most project failures. So at the first beginning, the programmer should clearly understand the problem. Plan the logic. The next step is to work out just how you are going to turn that specification into a working program. So first, plan the steps that the program will take. There are two common ways of planning the solution to a problem. We can draw a flowchart or write a pseudocode, or possibly we can do both. And use tools such as flowcharts and pseudocode. A flowchart is a pictorial representation of a step-by-step solution to a problem. It consists of arrows to represent the direction of the program and boxes and other symbols to represent actions. It is a map of what your program is going to do, and it is how going to do it. Then we have pseudocode. A pseudocode is an English-like non-standard language that lets you to state your solution with more precision than plain English, but with less precision than is required when using a formal programming language. Pseudocode permits you to focus on the program logic without having to be concerned of a particular programming language. However, pseudocode is not executable on the computer. We are going to learn about this pseudocode and flowcharts later. And walk through the logic before coding by desk checking the logic. Desk checking is an informal manual test that programmers can use to verify coding and algorithm logic before a program launch. This enables them to spot errors that might prevent a program from working as it should. Code the program. The next step is to code the program or to express your solution in a programming language. In this step, you translate the logic from the flowchart or pseudocode to a programming language. As we have already noted, a programming language is a set of rules that provides a way of instructing the computer what operation to perform. There are many programming languages. Basic, COBOL, Pascal, Fortran, and C are some examples. Although programming languages operate grammatically somewhat like English language, they are much more precise. To get your program to work, you have to follow exactly the rules, the syntax of the language you are using. The correct use of the language is the required first step. Then your coded program must be keyed and probably using a terminal or personal computer in a form of the computer can understand. In most cases, programmers usually use a text editor, which is something a bit like a word processor. Then, as the fourth step, use software to translate the program to machine language. Programmers write instructions in English like high-level languages. Compilers or interpreters change the programs into low-level machine language that can be executed. This is the process of turning the program written in some programming language into instructions made of zeros and ones that the computer can follow. This is necessary because the chip that makes your computer work only understands binary machine code. You can think of them simply as a translators that can read a programming language, translate it, and write the corresponding machine code. So this is how the compilation of a program is done. So user write the code and compile the program, and compiler give the errors, and again the user correct these errors, and the compiler turn the code into an executable program, and the program get inputs from the user, and the program gives the output to the user. So here you can see some errors. These are syntax errors. Those are identified by the compiler or interpreter. If you don't write very correct programs, they will complain. Think of them as a strictest sort of English teacher who picks you up on every single missing comma, misplaced apostrophe, and a grammatical error. Test the program. After coding the program, you must prepare to test it on the computer. These steps involve three phases: desk checking, translating, and debugging. Desk checking. In desk checking, you simply sit down and mentally trace or check the logic of the program to attempt to ensure that it is error-free and workable. Translating. A translator is a program that checks the syntax of your program to make sure the programming language was used correctly, giving you all the syntax error messages called diagnostics. Then the translator translates your program into a form of the computer can understand. A byproduct of the process is that the translator tells you if you have improperly used the programming language in some way. These types of mistakes are called syntax errors. The translator produces descriptive error messages. Debugging. A term used extensively in programming, debugging means detecting, locating, and correcting bugs, usually by running the program. These bugs are logical errors, such as telling a computer to repeat an operation but not telling it how to stop the repeating. In this space, you run the program using test data that you decide, and you must plan the test data carefully to make sure you test every part of the program. In the debugging, it execute with sample data and check results, and it identify logic errors and correct them, and choose test data carefully to exercise all branches of the logic. So the sixth or the last phase is deploying the program into production. So you should do this after testing is complete and all known errors have been corrected. And it may require coordination with other related activities or software. So next, we'll go to the data hierarchies. So data hierarchy refers to the systematic organization of data, often in a hierarchical form, or we can say as the ordering of data types by size. Data organization involves fields, records, files, and so on. A data field holds a single fact or attribute of an entity. Here in this picture, you can see the complete data hierarchy. So the main part is the database, and here you can see some tables, and these tables are consist of records, and these records are consist of fields. So we are going to discuss each of these components. Character. It is a single compound symbol. In the ASCII coding scheme, each byte represents a single character, which can be a number, a letter, a space, punctuation mark, or any other special characters. Here you have some examples. Field. a group of characters forming a single data item. For example, we can give the name field. A field is a combination of one or more related characters or bytes and is the smallest unit of data a user accesses. A field name uniquely identifies each field. The field size defines the maximum number of characters a field can contain. For example, for this field ID number, it has a value, and in the ID number field, the field name is the ID number. And also we can give the size to this field. For example, for this field, we can give the maximum number of characters as 10. Record. Record is a group of related fields. Here in this example, you can see, we can see a customer record, which is, it gives the customer name and the customer's address. File, a group of related records. Here in this example, you can see, you have the whole customer details file. Here you have the customer names of customers and names of and the addresses of these customers. And here you can see this details file consists of many records. Database. It is a collection of related files called tables that serve the information needs of the organization, may consist of many different files linked in a such way that information can be retrieved from several files at once. So here in this example, you have a restaurant database, and this database includes of customer details file, order details file, and a food item details file. So here you can see the hierarchy of a data. So the main the hierarchy, at the top of this hierarchy you can see database, and this database is consist of it files, and this file has records, and a record is consist about fields, and a field is consist with characters. So next we'll go into flowcharts and pseudocodes. As you all know, and algorithm is a representation of a solution to a problem. In the problem solving phase of computer programming, you will be designing algorithms. This means that you will have to be conscious of the strategies you use to solve the program in order to apply them to programming problems. These algorithms can be designed through the use of flowcharts or pseudocodes. Flowcharts. A flowchart is a pictorial representation of a logic and written with program flow from the top of a page to the bottom. A flowchart is a diagram made up of boxes, diamonds, and other shapes connected by arrows. Each shape represents a step in the process, and the arrows show the order which they occur. So we'll discuss some basic symbols of a flowchart that will help you to draw the flowchart. So this is the process symbol. This indicates any type of internal operation inside the processor or memory. And then we have input output symbols. This used for any input output operations indicates that the computer is to obtain data or output result. Flow lines. This shows the direction of flow and connect the steps. And we have this decision symbol. This is used to ask a question that can be answered in a binary format. So this decision symbol has two flow lines. They may be yes or no, or true or false. Terminal. This indicates the starting or ending of the program process or interrupt the program. Then we have the connector. This allows the flowchart to be drawn without intersecting lines or without reverse flow. Show the sequence of the statements. So for example, we'll see this flowchart to get the summation of two numbers. Here, study this flowchart and how they created this flowchart to get the summation. Backpointing arrows. Backpointing arrows show statement that will be repeated. Here, after printing the calculated number, the program needs to get another input. So here in this flowchart, we are using the backpointing arrow to start from the beginning, and also since there is no endpoint, this will run infinitely. Infinite loop. Infinite loop is a sequence of statements that repeats forever with no escape. To avoid infinite loops, we can test for predetermined values, that means stop processing. So again, we'll take the same example. Here this is an infinite loop, but to stop this, we could use a predetermined value. Sentinel value or a dummy value. A preselected value that stops the execution of a program. We can use these values with input from files or users. So here we have checked this flowchart. Here this is the modified flowchart of the earlier infinite flowchart. Here you can see this flowchart has a sentinel value which is 0. So if the user inputs 0, the program stops. End of file marker. We can use this instead of a sentinel value for file input. This marks the end of the data of a file that the program reads. Flowchart connector simple. Marks a logic transfer to another location in the flowchart. Transfer location can be on the same page or another page. So here you can see in the flowchart there are two symbols. One is on page symbol, which is a circle. It is a circle with a number or letter to identify the matching transfer location. Then we have this off page symbol. It is a square with pointed bottom containing the page number and a number of letters to identify the matching transfer location. So this is the basics of a flowchart. Thank you.